How you guys are doing? Today we will discuss about the pathologies of adrenal hormonal secretions. So first we'll discuss about the Addison disease. Addison disease, also called as adrenal insufficiency, it is a disorder which occurs when the body does not produce enough steroid hormones, especially cortisol and aldosterone. There can be multiple reasons. A few of them are mentioned here. For example, autoimmune atrophy of adrenal cortex. If there is autoimmune destructions of the cells of adrenal cortex, so it means the cells are not there, so they won't produce the adrenal cortical hormones. Second is tubular destruction. Due to the tubular destruction, again the cells are destroyed and they are not producing the sufficient hormones. The last one, if there is a cancer or which is compressing those cells, or the cancer which inhibits the normal functioning of the cells, then obviously this hormone will be low. So what happens to them? For example, if there is a mineralocorticoid deficiency, as you guys have already studied, the aldosterone, it causes the reabsorption of the sodium accompanied by the reabsorption of the water. So when there is no aldosterone or there is less aldosterone, it will lead to slight hyponatremia. As we have discussed it already, it won't be a grave hyponatremia because due to its relative concentration, due to reabsorption of the water or the secretion of the water, it is maintained. So it will also effect on the extracellular fluid volume when there will be less sodium reabsorption, less water reabsorption, so obviously the extracellular fluid volume will decrease. Again, you guys have already studied the hyperkalemia occur because aldosterone causes the secretion of the potassium into the tubular lumen. So there is less aldosterone, the secretion of the potassium will not occur, it will lead to the hyperkalemia. And you know, whenever there is a hyperkalemia, it affects the muscular activity, especially it can cause the cardiac abnormalities in the cardiac action potentials. Next is amyloidosis. As you know, the aldosterone, it causes the secretion of the hydrogen into the tubular lumen. If there is no aldosterone, so the hydrogen will not be secreted, and when hydrogen will not be secreted, it will get accumulated into the blood and it will lead to the acidosis. Acidosis is mild because there is always a respiratory compensation. There are two organs which are two systems which are basically help to maintain the pH of the body. One is the renal system, another is the respiratory system. So in this way, the respiratory system will help to maintain the acidosis to take the pH back towards the normal. So that's why it will be a mild acidosis. Next, what will happen to the glucocorticoid deficiency? Now keep in mind, all this mineralocorticoid deficiency, though it is yes, it can be due to the less amount of aldosterone, but it can also be due to the less amount of the glucocorticoids, for example, cortisol. So what happens in the glucocorticoid deficiency? As you know, the major effect of the cortisol hormone on the carb metabolism was to cause the hyperglycemia. So because it causes the gluconeogenesis, it causes the formation of it used to decrease the entry of the glucose into the cells. Eventually it was causing hyperglycemia normally, but here, as you know, that there is a deficiency of the glucocorticoid, so it will lead to the hypoglycemia, which can be threatening, of course. The next is that it reduces the mobilization of fats and proteins from the tissues, because it was its normal function of the cortisol that it used to mobilize the fats and the proteins from the extrahepatic tissues to the hepatic tissues and to the blood. So if it is not working, there will be less utilization, and the body won't be able to use that fat and the protein in case of excess need or excess demand, whenever there is a case of starvation and when there is a stress condition, body won't be able to use the proteins and fats. Next is the deteriorating effect of the stress. Yes, it is due to because it cannot utilize those fat and protein for the energy. In the fourth point, it affects the infections, especially respiratory infection. Why? Because the glucocorticoid, it helps to maintain the stress, it helps person to combat the infection. So if glucocorticoid is not there, so person will be more prone to the infections. There is a condition which is associated with the Addison disease, which is known as the Addisonian crisis. Addisonian crisis is due to the critical need of the extra glucocorticoid and associated debility in the times of the stress. As you know, at the time of the stress, body needs more energy. So that energy which body usually used to get through the cortisol by the mobilization of fats and the proteins, and the fat is used to cause the oxidation of the free fatty acid, and body used to produce energy. But here, as there is less cortisol, so body won't be able to cope that condition of the stress. Why? Because body cannot have extra energy. So this is known as the Addisonian crisis, which is critical need of extra glucocorticoid and associated debility in time of the stress. Here, body cannot provide extra glucocorticoid. Why? Because body is having Addison disease. Okay, this is a general description. Whenever ACTH is produced, it is produced by the pre-pro hormone is known as the pro-opiomelanocortin. As you know, whenever a protein is produced, it gets different kind of post-translational modification. It is produced into the pre-pro hormone, then pro-hormone, and then the final hormone. Whenever this ACTH is produced from this pre-pro hormone, which is known as pro-opiomelanocortin, it is not produced alone. As you can see, there are other hormones which are produced in conjunction with the ACTH. For example, lipotropin, beta endorphins, gamma lipotropin, and MSH. Well, MSH is melanocyte stimulating hormone, which actually causes the darkening of the skin. Now keep in mind, ACTH, it also has the MSH-like activity. Basically, the major MSH-like activities is caused by the ACTH, and also MSH obviously does cause the darkening of the skin because it causes the production of the pigmentation. Now keep in mind, whenever there is any abnormality which affects the more synthesis of ACTH, then obviously it will cause darkening of the skin. Why? Number one, because ACTH also has MSH-like activity. And whenever ACTH is produced from the pre-pro hormone, as you can see, MSH is also produced. So due to these two reasons, whenever there is any abnormality which is causing over-secretion of ACTH, it will cause the darkening or pigmentation of the skin. You can see the darkened skin. Okay, now what was the treatment of the Addison disease? Obviously, first, you need to treat the cause. If the cause can be treated, for example, through the tuberculosis destruction, if it is, you can give the anti-tuberculosis drugs. If it is not destroyed completely, though some of the cells are there, then yes, the cause can be alleviate the symptoms. If there is a cancer, accordingly treatment can occur. So one is that you give the Sorry for the slide shake. And other is the first one is that you remove the cause, if the cause can be removed, of course. Another is the orally administration of the glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids. Previously, we have discussed that there are synthetic glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids, which are actually more potent than the naturally occurring. So yes, as the main reason in the Addison disease was the deficiency of these steroid hormones. So if you give them orally to the patient or you administer them, so the patient can be treated. Okay, next disease is the Cushing syndrome. Now keep in mind, all these syndromes which I am discussing here, they are very important. They repeat in the exam quite often. What is a Cushing syndrome? Cushing syndrome is hypersecretion of adrenal cortex and causes a complex cascade of the hormonal effects. With all this combined, these effects are known as Cushing syndrome. Many of its abnormalities are ascribed to hypercortisolism, which means more cortisol hormone, but excess secretion of androgen may also cause some effects. So what is a Cushing syndrome? It is hypercortisolism. It can be due to the abnormal corticotropin release hormone release, whereby more release will cause the more formation of ACTH, it will cause the more formation of steroid hormones. Or it due to the some abnormality in the pituitary, for example pituitary adenoma, it will cause the more ACTH release. Same is the case if there is ectopic secretion of ACTH, for example there are some tumors of other parts body or other parts of the cell, for example some tumors of the kidney, they also produce the ACTH. Then there can be abnormality with the adrenal cortex, for example adrenal cortical adenoma, which is a tumor of the adrenal cortex, so obviously it will produce more cortisol. And the final point, if you are giving excessive administration of glucocorticoids to the patient, as we have discussed already, the glucocorticoids have anti-inflammatory effect, so we give to the patients in number of conditions where our main cause is to the reduced inflammation. So if there is excessive administration of glucocorticoids, it can also lead to the Cushing syndrome. And now keep in mind, we have already discussed the glucocorticoid, they do have the mineralocorticoid activity, but normally they are released in an optimum amount, but if there is abnormal release of the glucocorticoid, it can also exert a mineralocorticoid effect. We can divide the Cushing syndrome into the two types. One is ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome and other is the ACTH independent Cushing syndrome. ACTH dependent is those in which the ACTH secretion is more. So ACTH secretion is more, is increased either if there is a tumor of anterior pituitary. Obviously if there is tumor of anterior pituitary in the cells of ACTH secreting cell, it will lead to the more ACTH. Or if there is a more CRH. If there is more CRH, obviously it will have positive effect on ACTH secreting cell and it will lead to the more ACTH. The other type of Cushing syndrome is the ACTH independent Cushing syndrome. It means it does not depend on the ACTH secretion, but the abnormality lies in the adrenal cortex. So it can be due to the adrenal tumor or adrenal hyperplasia, or if you are giving exogenous glucocorticoid to the patient. All these causes, they do not depend on the ACTH secretion. No matter if ACTH secretion is more or less, as the cause lies in either adrenal cortex or exogenous glucocorticoid, so we call it as the ACTH independent Cushing syndrome. Now what is a Cushing disease? Though this terminology is obsolete in the new papers, in the new research articles, but still it does exist in our books. The physiology, you will also get it in Sherwood and Guyton, and this question is repeated again and again in the Viva and in the exam. So you should know the Cushing disease is basically, we call it Cushing's, is when Cushing syndrome is due to excess secretion of ACTH by anterior pituitary, it is called the Cushing disease. So here it lies. ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome, when ACTH secreting tumor of anterior pituitary, we call it as Cushing disease. That is, that limited part is called Cushing disease. Otherwise, all other parts, it causes the Cushing syndrome. So Cushing disease, when Cushing syndrome is due to excess secretion of ACTH by anterior pituitary, it is called Cushing disease. So you can see that it is overlapping term. Maybe get the idea. Now how do we distinguish between ACTH dependent and ACTH independent Cushing syndrome? There is a method, we call it as a dexamethasone suppression test. It is a dexamethasone suppression test in which you give the patient a large dose of dexamethasone. Dexamethasone is basically a synthetic analog of the cortisol. It has cortisol-like activity, but it is synthetic and it is more potent than a normal naturally occurring cortisol. So what do? When we give the large doses of dexamethasone to the patient, if ACTH does not suppress, you know, normally a dexamethasone, which is just like a cortisol, it should have a negative feedback mechanism on the ACTH secreting cell or on the CRH secreting cell, and it should inhibit ACTH secretion. But if you are giving dexamethasone and ACTH secretion does not suppresses, it means that the disease or the Cushing syndrome is ACTH dependent. So this is the ACTH dependent. It means there was either a tumor of anterior pituitary or that of the CRH releasing cells. So no matter how much dexamethasone you give to that patient, your ACTH will not suppress. Why? Because ACTH is not under the negative feedback control of this dexamethasone or the cortisol, which is normally producing in the body. On the other hand, if you give the last dose of dexamethasone to the patient and ACTH suppresses, it means it is ACTH independent. Here you can see. It means there is some adrenal tumor, or there was adrenal hyperplasia, or there was exogenous glucocorticoids. They will have a negative feedback effect on the ACTH secreting cell of the anterior pituitary, of the CRH releasing cell on the hypothalamus. So ACTH will suppress. So in this way you can differentiate between ACTH dexamethasone suppression test, but you can differentiate between ACTH dependent and ACTH independent Cushing syndrome. So what are the signs and symptoms of the Cushing syndrome? One is the buffalo torso. We have discussed it already. Due to the mobilization of the fats, at some point it is more mobilized and at other points it is less mobilized. So it gives a typical posture we call as the buffalo torso, in which there is a more fat absorption in the upper part of the body. Next is the moon face shape. Here you can see the picture. It is due to the salt and water retention. Why? Because excess glucocorticoid, it also has mineralocorticoid activity, and also the facial obesity due to the fat mobilization. And third, it causes the hypertension. Why? Because of the, yes, it can be due to the increased mineralocorticoid release, or it is because the mineralocorticoid effect of the cortisol. Hyperglycemia, as you know, that the normal function of the cortisol is to cause the hyperglycemia. If it is so much, then it can lead to the adrenal diabetes. Muscular weakness, why? Because we have discussed it already that cortisol causes the increased catabolism of the muscle, and it decreases the synthesis of the muscle, and it mobilizes the amino acids from the extrahepatic tissue, with for example muscular tissue and lymphoid tissue, to the liver. So obviously it will lead to the muscular weakness. It can be due to the fact that patient cannot stand up from the sweating position. Another point is the suppression of immune system. Yes, suppression of immune system does occur. Why? If there is decreased protein synthesis in the lymphoid tissue, no proteins in the lymphoid tissue, no antibodies or no WBCs, RBCs and other cell, so not RBCs, WBCs and other cells, so it will lead to the suppression of immune system. Subcutaneous tear or purplish striae due to the depletion of collagen in subcutaneous tissue. Collagen is also a protein. So as cortisol causes the mobilization of the protein from extrahepatic to the hepatic tissue, so due to the depletion of the collagen, patient will be having subcutaneous tears in the subcutaneous area. And whenever there are tear, there will be a leakiness of the blood, and it will give up a typical purplish color, and we call it as the purplish stria. Now again, due to diminished proteins in the bones, why? Because the proteins have been mobilized from the extrahepatic to the hepatic tissue, it will cause the weakness of the bone, and we call this condition as osteoporosis. So these are all the effects of the Cushing syndrome. What can be the treatment? Obviously, first is the removal of the cause. Whatever the cause, the patient is getting so much exogenous glucocorticoids, or there is a tumor, it can be of hypothalamus, anterior pituitary, or adrenal cortex. So first is the removal of the cause by the surgery or by radiation, whatever the way. Second is steroidogenesis blocker. There are some drugs which inhibits the synthesis of the steroid hormones. For example, metirapone and ketoconazole, they inhibit its synthesis. The last one is the ACTH secretion inhibitors. If there is a problem with ACTH secretion, there are some inhibitors, for example, serotonin antagonist and GABA transamine inhibitors. They can inhibit the secretion. So it is according to the cause. Okay, next one is the Cone syndrome. In the Cone syndrome, it is basically due to the more release of the mineralocorticoid. It is a tumor of the zona glomerulosa cell. Usually it is caused by the tumor of zona glomerulosa cell, in which there are more mineralocorticoids. So we have discussed the effects of mineralocorticoid or aldosterone again and again. Again, I give you idea. Whenever there is more mineralocorticoid, or you say there is more aldosterone, what will happen? It will cause more sodium reabsorption, more water reabsorption, ECF volume will increase, and hypertension will occur. Then it will cause hypokalemia. Why? Because it will secrete the potassium ion. Whenever there is a hyperkalemia, normal action potential, depolarization process of the nerves and the muscle, it cannot be made, so it will lead to the paralysis. There is mild alkalosis. Why? Because aldosterone causes release of more hydrogen ion. It secretes the hydrogen ion in the tubular lumen. So when hydrogen ion are released, it will lead to the alkalosis. Why it is mild? Obviously here also due to the respiratory compensation. What is the diagnostic criteria? In diagnostic criteria, obviously you will get all the sign and symptoms, plus there will be decreased plasma renin concentration. Why renin concentration will be low? Because renin is released when there is hypotension, but here in this case it is hypertension, so renin will be low in the body. Treatment is to treat the cause. Obviously here usually the cause is the tumor of the zona glomerulosa. If the surgically remove, or you remove it through the radiation, so then the process can be reversed. I want you guys to memorize this table, because it will help you in diagnosis. Cushing disease, cortisol level high, ACTH high or normal, you know the reason why. Cushing syndrome, cortisol high and ACTH is low. In Addison, cortisol is low and ACTH is high. Next is the adrenogenital syndrome. As we have discussed, the adrenal cortex also produces the sex hormones. So whenever there is an abnormality with the production of the sex hormone, there it leads to the adrenogenital syndrome. For example, in the female, it leads to the virile characteristic, the characteristic which are specific for the males. For example, growth of a beard, deeper voice, baldness, distribution of hair on the body, for example, on the, especially on the pubis and in the armpits, growth of the clitoris to resemble a penis and deposition of the fat in it, and all the masculine characteristics. If there are more release of the female sex hormones, if there are more release of the sex hormones in the females, it will lead to the all these characters in the females. Now in the prepubertal males, same characteristics, although which I've discussed already, they will occur as in the females, and there is a rapid development of the male sexual organs. In the adult males, though all the genital organs they have already synthesized, but the adrenogenital syndrome, that's where they are usually obscured by the normal virilizing characteristics of the testosterone. Because in the adult males, all the male secondary and the primary sex characters they have developed already. So it will be difficult to diagnose that condition, because a patient can confuse it, because the normal testosterone, it also causes all these same effects like deeper voice, baldness, growth of a beard. So it will be difficult to diagnose the adrenogenital syndrome. Hope you guys get this lecture.